of terrible pictures yesterday. We heard about a lot of horrible injuries, and I know it impacted you. The good news is I'm not going to show any of those photos today. You will have those photos as part of the exhibits that you get in this case, and to the extent you need to look at them and refer to them, you can. But today, this is the photo that I want to show. Hermes Askedon, a favorite son of a neighborhood in South Los Angeles. As a young man, he did join a gang. He was wayward in his ways, but over time, he changed. The streets he used to run as a young man became the life material that he used to become a voice for those same streets. And while some people get successful, they make money, they leave their neighborhoods, they change their address, this man was different. He wanted to change the neighborhood. He invested in the neighborhood. He kept the same friends from the neighborhood. And the neighborhood loved him. And they called him Neighborhood Nip. There's a lot more to this man. He was, and you know through the evidence in this case, a caring person. This is not his child, but he was a father, he was a son, he was a brother, he was a human being. And I stress that because sometimes in a murder case we lose sight of that. This case is a little extraordinary because the victim is a familiar person. But by its nature, a murder trial is less about how a person lived than about how they died. Still, we learned some things about this man through this trial. This photograph tells you a lot about him, and this just minutes before he would be killed by Eric Holden. This little child is wearing a shirt that says Crenshaw. The neighborhood, purchased from his store. Maybe a gift, we don't know. We know that this man was accessible, right? We know that he showed up, no entourage, no security, no fanfare. We know that when he accomplished something, he allowed others to take credit for his success. One of the most poignant moments in this trial, and there were a lot, was when Cowboy was on the stand, Herman Douglas, and he was being cross-examined by Mr. Jansen, and Mr. Jansen said, well, on direct examination, I noticed you kept saying, we own this, we own that. And Herman Douglas kind of dropped his head, and he said, well, yeah, that's because whenever Nipsey bought something, he said, we bought that. Whenever he accomplished something, he said, we did that. That's the kind of person that he was. That's the kind of person that he was on the day that he was killed. He was the kind of person that could create an image like this. Now, for some people looking at this, this might not mean a lot, but if you know anything about the gangs in South LA, this is an extraordinarily powerful image. Two gangs, bitter rivals for generations. A lot of blood spilled between these two gangs, just a mile apart from each other. And at the occasion of Nipsey Hussle's death, you see it coming together in respect for this man. And as the defense's own gang expert put it, everybody loved him. He transcended what it meant to be a rolling 60. He transcended it, but he didn't reject it because he had that kind of loyalty in him. But he was no longer a gangbanger. He was a world-known recording artist and so much more. And it really is a shame that his life was so brutally and coldly taken on his own property, in his own name. somebody that he considered a friend, somebody that he had just shook hands with just minutes before. There is a real tragic irony in that. But here we are now to mete out justice for what happened that day in the full measure of it, not partial. I want to go through the events of that day with you, but based on the defense in this case, there's really a very narrow issue before you. There is no issue of identification, right? And that's because we had so many cameras out there and people who knew him and the driver who brought him there. This case was never going to be a whodunit. It was never going to be I didn't do it. There is no issue of self-defense raised in this case. So that's out. The only issue that the defense has raised, the only sliver of argument that can be made, is that Nipsey Hussle did something to arouse a strong emotional response from Mr. Holbrook. That was so provocative that it overtook and obscured his reason and judgment. And then he killed because of that. I'm going to talk more about that. But let's go through the events of that day. March 31st, 2019. This location. At that time, the center of the neighborhood. Property owned by Nipsey Hussle and others, his family, and some successful businesses being run out of this strip mall. They didn't own all of the businesses, but the ones they didn't own, they leased to others. A very, very familiar place in the neighborhood and very familiar to the 60s. Well, on that day, Nipsey Hussle arrived. And he arrived alone. His car is parked here. He gets out of the car. And the first person he greets is Rimpa. So it's about 2:53 p.m. Out. He's got his white do-rag on. He's got freshly braided hair. Walks up to Rimpa and they dap it up. All good. Probably happened hundreds, if not thousands, of times. Just as they start to talk, I don't know if you can see, but Cowboy is on his way out of the store, and he's going to meet up with them, and they're going to start to converse. The next significant thing that happens is Mr. Holder arrives. This is about 10 minutes later. We still see Cowboy and Rimpa and Nipsey talking as Ms. Nicholson pulls her car into the parking lot. Just another beautiful Sunday afternoon in Los Angeles. Ms. Nicholson pulls in and she sees Nipsey Hussle. My goodness, she didn't expect that. She got excited. Oddly, Mr. Holder didn't say a word. He didn't say, "Oh, I know this. Oh, that's my homie." He didn't say anything. That's odd. Because most people in that situation would say, "Oh yeah, we go way back," or "I'll introduce you," or "Do you want a picture with them?" It's odd that he said nothing at all. She pulled up the car, and we know Mr. Holder gets out. He walks into the Master Burger, He orders, turned out to be chili cheese fries, and then he walks over to the group. You see him here, no shirt, and he just goes around, shakes everybody's hand, including Nipsey's. And that starts about a 4-minute conversation. Ms. Nicholson sees Mr. Holder walk into this group, not expecting that, thinking that he's a fanboy and he's going over there to get a photograph or a picture, so she jumps out of her car to go meet up with him. And this is almost as soon as Holder gets over to the group. This is only about 15. He's only there about 15 seconds before she goes over to get her photograph. And she ends up being there for less than a minute, and that includes the time it took her to get a photograph. Now, there's a conversation happening, and we have two witnesses give different accounts of what they heard. We have Mr. Douglas, who was there for the entire conversation. And we have Ms. Nicholson, who's not involved in gangs at all. She does not know this culture. She walks up and she catches probably about 40 seconds or so of conversation. Whatever the conversation was, and we'll talk more about that, everybody agrees it was kind of a normal, casual conversation. It wasn't hostile. Didn't look like a fight was about to happen. No one seemed agitated. There's a difference in substance of what was said or what each person heard, but there is no difference in that this looked like an ordinary conversation. At the time, she walks up, it is Nipsey, Mr. Holder, Cowboy, Grandpa, and another individual that we just were never able to identify. If you watch the video, you'll see he's there for a little while, he gets some kind of an autograph, and then he leaves. Ms. Nicholson gets her photograph, and looks at the smile on her face that she's happy. She has no idea what situation Mr. Holder is about to put her into. She has no idea that she's going to become a wanted person in the murder of one of LA's most beloved people. She takes this photograph, she hightails it back to her car, and immediately goes on social media and posts her photograph. Ms. Nicholson said, testified, that while she was standing there, she heard Mr. Holder talking. And she heard him use the word snitch as if he were calling Nipsey Hussle a snitch. That's what she said she heard. She didn't know the context. She didn't know what was said before or after. It didn't seem to bother her. Think that she wasn't troubled by it, whatever the tone was, wasn't troubling to her. But she said that's what she remembered hearing. She did not hear Nipsey say anything other than it seemed like he was just trying to stay chill and just kind of just brush whatever Mr. Holder was saying off. That's her description of what she heard. We know Mr. Douglas said, well, no, I never heard the word snitch. Nipsey definitely didn't say the word snitch, and I never heard of the word snitch. This was a conversation between two homies, where one is trying to tell the other one, who hasn't been around, so may not know, that there's some stuff going around about you that you might want to take care of. It was more in the nature of advice. And it was cool. Think about Cowboy hope he doesn't mind me calling him that. It's easier to say than Herman Douglas. He grew up in this neighborhood, right? This neighborhood is a neighborhood with some bad people in the neighborhood doing some bad things. There's no doubt about that. But it's also a neighborhood of some good people and some tough people, at least they wear a certain facade of toughness. And probably because of the environment that they are growing up in and living in, they find that useful. But every single person from the neighborhood who came in here and testified, including Cowboy, showed that vulnerability that lies just beneath. They all got emotional, in this case, when talking about Nipsey Hussle. As much as they didn't want to show it, and you could tell they didn't want to show it, from Carrie Lathan, who was clearly trying to avoid questions, to Cowboy, to Ingrid, Danae Wright, they all sort of had a moment of breakdown when talking about Nipsey Hussle and what happened to him that day. Now, Cowboy, he's an OG from the neighborhood. You can't tell him anything. Talk about a gang expert. What gang expert is going to be better on the Rolling 60s than Herman Douglas? And I think you could tell from the character of his testimony that he's a straight shooter. He goes on Instagram and tells people, I don't care what you think about me and what I'm doing, because I know I'm doing the right thing. You grow up in a neighborhood like this, the one we're talking about here, where the 60s claiming. I hate to use that because it doesn't belong to them. Still, it is an area where there are pockets of concentrated poverty in this neighborhood, and there is a gang that exists there, and it thrives there. The young men who grow up there learn, I think more than the average person, to be aware of suspicious behavior or anything that can be threatened. There's an expression that you live with your head on a swivel because you're constantly looking for an enemy. Anybody who wants to get a 60 will go to this area because that's where they'll likely find one. So you look for danger. He didn't see anything or hear anything that day that made him think for one moment that there was any hostility or that Mr. Holder felt any hostility toward Nipsey Hussle. So whatever that conversation, and we don't have a recording of it. Whatever it was, we don't see the hostility in the video. The witnesses who were there and within earshot didn't hear or see any hostility, the likes of which you would expect if there was some provocative act that would give rise to a heat of passion defense. Just wasn't there. Herman Douglas loved Nipsey Hussle. He still loves him. I think that came across very clearly, if nothing else, in the way he dresses, but the way he talks about him is so authentic. If he thought for one moment Nipsey would have been in danger, he never would have left the parking lot to go eat his salad or whatever he had for lunch. He never would have allowed Nipsey to stay in the parking lot. He knows Nipsey doesn't have security. He knows he's not armed. He knows he's out there bare in front of the world. He wouldn't have allowed it. That's some of your best evidence that whatever this conversation was about, it wasn't provocative in nature. Ms. Nicholson goes back to her car. And Mr. Holder leaves that conversation. He goes back to the Master Burger. He then walks out to her car because he needs additional money to pay for a drink or something. He goes back into the Master Burger. He then walks out and walks over to the group again, shakes a couple of hands, and he leaves. They leave about 3:18. So they think they're there for about 6 minutes total. And they leave out in her car, and she takes off, and she says she's ready to go, but he's given the directions. This is not her city, it's his city. And he tells her, turn here, turn there, basically go around the block. And she said he was acting normally. He didn't say anything about Nipsey. He wasn't complaining. He didn't say anything like, who does he think he is? He doesn't own this city. He doesn't own this neighborhood, nothing like that. Said he seemed normal. But as she turned that block back on the Slauson, she saw him manipulating what she saw for the first time that day, the black semi-automatic handgun. It looked like he was putting bullets in the magazine. And she, alarmed that he was going to shoot either at her or out the car, she says, you're not about to shoot from my car. And he just kind of shrugs it off and puts the gun away. He was already planning to kill Nipsey Hussle, ladies and gentlemen. That's planning. That's premeditation and deliberation. That's thinking about it before you do it. Already. Puts the gun away. He tells her, okay, turn here. Oh, go over here. I'm going to eat my fries. So she drives behind that Fat Burger and into the alley. He starts eating his fries. He puts on his shirt for the first time that day. Why? Because he knows he's going back. He's already planning that. There's no reason for him to walk around all day with no shirt on, get in the car, and then all of a sudden put the shirt on in the car. He's putting that shirt on to give him whatever element of surprise he can get. The thing is, when you walk around with no shirt on, you look extra, right? People tend to notice you a little bit faster. As Ingrid said, when she saw him standing there with no shirt on, that's what kind of caught her eye, because he's like, okay. He put the shirt on, and then the approach he took back to the group was to stay out of their view until he was right up on them. He walked back down the alley with his fries, placed them on the hood of a truck as he made his way around back to the strip mall. And he laid eyes on the group that was still congregated between those two cars. It was Nipsey, Perry, Shermine, Rimpaul. So he turns the corner. He didn't go into the parking lot so they could see him approach from the middle of the parking lot. He walks along the back side of them with two guns. One that he likely had the whole time in his front pocket, based on the bulge and the imprint that you can see when he's in the Mastersburg. But now we know he has two. Whether he had the other one the whole time or whether it was somewhere in the car, we don't know, but we know he has two at this point. And he's walking up on this group, having a Sunday conversation. They have no idea what's about to happen to them. This is that video clip in real time. The problem is the holder here. couple of things to note. And forgive me if I repeat myself. I have a tendency to get ahead of myself. But when he walked up to the group, he said, "Your group." To Nipsey Hussle. "Your group." He didn't say, "I'm not a snitch." He didn't say, "Why are you talking about me?" He didn't say, "Why are you hating on me?" He said, "You're through." Now, I don't think I'm overstating this or overthinking it, but when you say "you're through" to somebody, that seems like a broader kind of rejection of the person. Here you have Nipsey Hussle, who's a successful artist from the same neighborhood as Mr. Holder, who's an unsuccessful rap artist. Obviously beloved, everybody's taking pictures with him. The girl who brought him to the parking lot is excited to see him. I submit to you that the motive, for killing Nipsey Hussle had little or nothing to do with the conversation they had. There's already a pre-existing jealousy or envy in Eric Holder toward Nipsey Hussle.
Objection. Arguing facts and evidence.
Ladies and gentlemen, you heard all the evidence. It is your determination to decide the facts. Counsel are arguing their recollection, but you are to decide the facts from the evidence presented in this court only. Thank you.
Now, I will remind you, motive is not an element of the offense, and the people don't have to prove it. Sometimes motive is obvious in a crime, sometimes it's not. There's some indications here of motive, though, and you're free to agree or disagree with what I say about this. But in never telling Ms. Nicholson that he knows Nipsey Hussle, especially when she points out that she's excited to meet him, and making no comment once he got back into the car, and saying "you're through" right before shooting him, and shooting him the number of times that he did, and then kicking him in the head after he's already shot him 10 or 11 times, that's personal. That wasn't based on some conversation about some hood rumor. Counsel can disagree, but that's the evidence that we heard in the case. When you watch this again, I'm gonna play it, cropped in a little bit more in super slow-mo. Notice that when Holder approaches the crew, they see him and they're still just sitting there for a split second. And once he pulls out the gun, you see Nipsey reach. He sees it first. Everybody else is still sitting there. And then he starts firing. Nipsey drops first. And he drops like dead weight. It is likely that the first or second shot is the one that severed his spine. Because once he goes down, he's on his side and he's on his back. And he is living through being shot over and over again because you can see as he's on the ground, he can't move his legs, but he can still move his arm, and he's holding like his arm up as he's being shot over and over. After he goes down, Kerry Lathan turns to run. He catches a bullet in his back that drops him to the ground. And he can't. He can't even crawl. In between shooting Nipsey and Lathan, Shermai gets shot. Because when you watch the video, you can see, we know he's shot in the front. After Nipsey goes down, Shermai starts to turn and run. exposing his back. That shot had to come before he turned to run. Holder went over there, I submit to you, to shoot everybody that was in that space. And I tell you why. Because he doesn't know who else might be packing. He knew when he left the parking lot and started loading his gun that Nipsey wasn't out there by himself. He knew that there were people around him. He doesn't know who's armed and who's not armed. So when he goes back with not one, but two guns. Because he doesn't know what kind of resistance he's going to face. But he knows he's going to take out everybody right there to make sure that he doesn't get shot and that he has an opportunity to shoot the others. And that's exactly what he did. The only reason Renfrew didn't get shot is because he got out of there. I mean, he's like a track star running out of that space. Even in slow motion, it's going to look like Renfrew is running at regular speed. That's how fast he was. Let's take a look at it. See Nipsey here. Arms up. Defensive posture, but unable to move. Holder. Now, when you watch this, you'll see when Holder fires his first few shots, he starts to run from between the cars. He backs out of there because he doesn't know if there's going to be bullets coming his way. I mean, this is Roland 60's sort of meeting place. The fact that no one out there had a gun that day is a little surprising. But he caught them all slipping. He caught them all slipping. And once he realizes nobody's shooting back, what does he do? He runs back and shoots some more, and then he retreats. Nobody's shooting, he runs back and he shoots some more. He shoots 13 shots, maybe 14, we don't know exactly, because we don't know how many he started with, but we know 8 came from the semi-automatic. And the rest came from the revolver. Then he flees past the Master Burger. Poor Christian Johnson is scared for his life down on the floor. And we can at least see the revolver in his hand as he runs by. Let me say a word about Christian Johnson and some of the other witnesses. I think it was Mr. Douglas who said, video tells the whole story. The video tells, if all you had is the video in this case, you would know Eric Holder ambushed this group of men and shot and killed Nipsey Hussle in cold blood. The video tells you that. You don't need a witness to tell you anything. But I did call some witnesses because it's my prerogative. But I also thought as jurors, you're going to see some people and might wonder who they are or what they saw or heard. So for example, Mr. Johnson, he was in the Master Burger with Holder. He was there during some conversation between Holder and some young women. Did I need to call him as a witness? No. He didn't really advance the ball much, but he was there. And he was willing to come to court, and he was willing to tell you what little he saw and heard and how it impacted him. Same thing with Danae Wright. You remember Danae Wright? She was the woman who jumps out of her car and starts running. Then she runs back to the car and she runs again. When I saw the video, I noticed that. And I wonder, why is she running back and forth to the car? You don't realize from just watching the video that she has a child or children inside that car. And what a terrible thing it must be to be a parent in that situation. Right? Because we all would like to think that if we were in that situation, we would never leave our kids, right? But you just never know how life will put you in situations where you don't prepare, you can't rehearse for this. Do I run? Do I say, oh, my kids? Do I go back? Do I stay? I can't even imagine what that was like for her. So this crime, these bullets just didn't kill Nipsey Hussle and injure Shermai and Lathan. These bullets traumatized the whole community. Crimes like this, the enormity of these crimes is that they can't be contained. Even as bad as it is, murder is, attempted murder is, assault with a firearm, as bad as those crimes are, there are a lot of unnamed victims in this. And the bullets land either in a person or they hit a wall, they stop. But in a figurative sense, these bullets are still traveling. This neighborhood has not forgotten. And that's part of the enormity of the crime. Mr. Holder turned the corner, and we get a look at both guns, one in each hand, as he runs by, I think that's camera 21. And he's already on his way back to Ms. Nicholson's car, where he had her leave it because he knew what he was about to do and where he wanted that car to be when he got back. He wanted it to be ready to go. Facing 58th place, ready to get out of there. He knew when he got out of that car with his French fries what he was going to do. That is premeditation and deliberation. Thought about it ahead of time, and then he did it. That's all premeditation and deliberation means. It doesn't mean that you plan something for weeks. Okay? It means you think about it, and you do it. We all engage in premeditated and deliberate acts every day. Some of the most ordinary decisions we make involve thinking about what we're doing, consequences, and then doing it. Crime is no different. He started thinking about this well ahead of actually pulling the trigger. He could have stopped at any time. When she said, what are you doing with that gun? He could have changed his mind. He didn't. When she parked behind the Fat Burger, he could have said, you know what, let's go. He didn't. As he's walking down the alley, calmly, with his French fries, he could have changed his mind and went back, but he didn't. When he turned the corner and he saw that Nipsey Hussle was sitting there with other people, people he didn't necessarily know, but he knew he was about to shoot, He could have changed his mind, but he didn't. That's what it means to premeditate and deliberate on an act. After each shot, he could have stopped, but he took the next one and the next one. That's premeditation and deliberation. He jumps in the car at 58th place. We've got a little bit of video of that. Now, Ms. Nicholson said she heard the shot. She was about to leave. She didn't know what was going on. We see her kind of inching out. And she stops. He eventually gets to the car, and he tells her to drive. And she takes off. Now let's talk a little bit about Ms. Nicholson. You know from the evidence, we took a long, hard look at Ms. Nicholson. Not that she knew that Nipsey Hussle was going to get shot, but we looked at her behavior after the shooting. She heard gunshots. She saw him with a gun. He comes back with two guns. Later, she hears Nipsey Hussle got shot. She knows they were there. Question arises when she allowed him to stay at the mother's house, when she let him use her ID to get a room the next day. Was she doing that to assist him in evading the police? Right? It's a natural question that you would want to take a long, hard look at. Because that question existed, and she was being called to testify, both at the grand jury and here, it raises a question of what her rights are under the law. She doesn't know her rights, unless you tell her. So before she was interviewed by Mr. Washington, he told her, these are your Miranda rights. You waive these rights and agree to talk to us. She said, yes. 5 hours. No, you know, I need a break now. I want a lawyer now. No, she cooperated. 5 hours. And then later, she was asked to meet with the district attorney. Again, she was advised of her rights. She waived them. We talked. Another 2 hours. We got to the grand jury. You know from the evidence that I initiated the immunity agreement with her because she was going to testify under oath. It is the better practice to make sure that the witness has a lawyer and understands that she has a right to request immunity. She didn't know she had the right to request that, and she never did until she was told. So we granted her what's called use immunity. Use immunity means we're giving you immunity for what you're going to say in this limited place. Not transactional immunity, which is immunity against ever prosecuting you. It's a broader immunity. We're just going to immunize the statements that you make in court. We already had 7 hours of interviews with her, statements from her. If we were going to prosecute her, we already had the evidence to do. But the decision was made, and she was never charged with any crime because you may not see it the same way. But I'm taking time to say this. She's not on trial here, obviously, but I'm taking the time to say this because I think it's important. In listening to her testify and how she processes information and how she makes decisions, whether it was willful neglect or willful blindness, she was honest when she said, I really wasn't convinced he did it until I saw it on the news. suspect many people, the moment he came running back to that car, would have been highly suspicious. And certainly by the time they got home and saw on social media that Nipsey Hussle was shot, many people would have put two and two together at that moment. I don't think she did. And I think that comes across in the evidence. And she really wasn't convinced until she saw a news report. That's either here nor there. But I took the time to say that because I wanted to explain what the immunity was all about, if you had any questions about that. What was impressive about her is she immediately gave up her phone. And not just here, you can look at my phone. You can extract all the data from my phone. You think about how much personal information we all have on our phones. It's probably making some of you uncomfortable to even think that somebody could go in your phone and extract all the data. All the phone calls, text messages, photos. It was impressive that without knowing that was coming, she said yes. Search my car, search my apartment, search my mom's house. And we did. And after doing our due diligence, she got the agreement that we gave her, and you heard her testimony, which is the most important thing. They hightail it back to Long Beach. Meanwhile, pandemonium is breaking out. On the floor.
Okay, this is good. Okay, so we're just hanging on, right? That noise is already here, right?
Did all of this to a neighborhood that he didn't live in for quite some time. We don't know exactly when he left the neighborhood, but he wasn't living here anymore. Which also kind of raises the question of why would he care what rumors are going around about him in a neighborhood where he doesn't even live? Right? He hardly comes around. Nobody's seen him in a long time. So how can a rumor inspire so much rage in a person to justify a manslaughter? You know, it's like he said to Nipsey when Nipsey was telling him that this was going around. What did he say? He said, oh man, they're just haters. They're just haters. He just brushed it off because it's not a big deal. We know it's not a big deal because the defense's own gang expert testified that it's not a big deal. These things happen all the time in the hood. There's always rumors going around. It's a rumor mill. And when they do happen, there's a way to deal with it. And how did he say it's dealt with? The same way that Herman Douglas said it's dealt with. You get confronted that there's something going on. Okay, let me take care of it. Let me show you that I didn't do that. All the time. Ordinary. Not extraordinary. The charges. The judge gave you a lot of law. We're going to talk about the law, especially the law of heat of passion. But let's get the charges clear. Count one is murder. We're going to get into the definition of murder a little bit, but basically, murder is of two degrees. And the best way to think about murder is, think of it this way. All murder, by default, is second degree murder, unless something makes it first degree. What makes this murder first degree is premeditation and deliberation. A murder with premeditation and deliberation makes murder first degree murder. There are other things that will make a murder first degree, but they don't apply here. Shooting from a moving vehicle would make a murder a first degree murder. And there are other things, but here we're relying on premeditation and deliberation. Counts two and three go to victim Carrie Lathan. We allege in count two that Mr. Holder is guilty of attempted murder of Carrie Lathan. We also allege that he's guilty of assault with a firearm. These charges cover the same conduct. Same conduct charged in two different ways. They both define distinct crimes. You'll be asked to reach a verdict if you can on both counts. Don't worry about the fact that they overlap or they point to the same conduct. That's contemplation. That's for the judge to worry about. If he's convicted of both, the judge knows how to handle that. But we charged him with attempted murder because, as I told you, the evidence shows that he went over there willing and intending to kill everybody in that space. Nipsey was clearly his target, but he was intending to kill everybody or chase them away if they happened to get away, and they did. Attempted murder is when a person takes a direct step toward killing another person. That's what it requires, a direct step, more than mere planning. So let's say Eric Holder got his guns, he got out of Brianita's car, and he started walking over to the mall, intending to kill, and then changed his mind and went back to the car. Before he pulled the gun on anybody, before he pointed it, before he pulled the trigger, the question, is that attempted murder? Because he had the intent to kill, but did he take a direct step toward killing? Probably not. Not if he shuts it down in the alley and goes back to the car. So far removed from actually carrying out the act. But once you point a gun at somebody and you pull the trigger, you've taken more than a direct step toward carrying out the act. The law doesn't require that the gun be fired. Attempted murder does not require that a victim be injured at all. The focus is on the conduct of the perpetrator. Did he have the intent to kill, and did he take a direct step toward killing? We submit to you he did in the cases of Shermai and Lathan. And there's no better evidence of that than he struck both of them. He actually shot both of them. Assault with a firearm, you point a gun at somebody, it's the assault is completed as soon as you point the gun at them. You know, whether you intend to fire it or not, it's a no moment. attempted murder, I know you will grapple with that. You go through the facts, look at the video, understand the context of the situation. And I'm confident that you're going to agree that when he went over there, he was intending to kill anybody that was there. And the only reason he did it is because Lathan went down, became a non-threat. Shermai ran away after getting hit, turned the corner, became a non-threat. And Renpaul took off across the parking lot, never to be seen again. I mean, literally, well, he was seen again, because we heard he was interviewed. But he didn't come to court to testify. Now, that's probably the one witness that if I could have produced him, would have produced him, because he was also there during the conversation. But, you know, we tried. So counts 2 and 3, counts 4 and 5, same counts, but instead of Lathan, they're aimed at Shermai. Shermai is the victim in these two counts, but it's the same concept for him. And count 6 is felon with firearm. Mr. Holder had previously been convicted of a felon. As a convicted felon, he could not possess a firearm, and we know on this day he possessed not one, but 2 firearms. So I know the judge read a lot of instructions to you, and it sounded very complicated. But by the time I'm done, I hope that you're going to say, okay, this is manageable. We understand what the prosecution's theory is here in this case. 1 count of murder, 2 counts of attempted murder for each victim, 2 counts of assault for the same 2 victims, and 1 count of felon with a firearm. Some of the law I've already talked about, so I can go through this quickly. But it looks like it's lunchtime. So what do you want to do?
Will you be finished in 5 minutes?
No.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's take our
go ahead and your order back.
By the judge, and I mentioned this also, all available evidence is not required in the trial. So there may have been people in that parking lot that I didn't call. You shouldn't speculate about why they weren't called. It's my job to prove the case beyond a reasonable doubt, and I call the witnesses that I think fairly can testify about the things that you need to know to make a decision. So all available evidence is not required. Also, motive. We talked about this. Motive is not an element case. I do think there is some evidence of motive. Obviously, there was a conversation that preceded the killing. That conversation was fairly unremarkable. And there were other things about Nipsey Hussle's fame and his love in his neighborhood that Mr. Holder did not enjoy that I previously argued, I think, played a role in why he did what he did. Murder is a crime that is very, very simply defined. It happens when a person commits an act that causes the death of another person. And the defendant or the perpetrator acts with what we call malice aforethought, which is simply defined as an intent to kill. And there's 2 types of malice in the law. There's express malice and implied malice. Obviously, in this case, based on these facts, we have evidence of express malice. Shooting somebody with a gun multiple times can't be anything other than an expression of express malice. Once you have those two elements, you have murder. I told you murder is defined in two degrees. The default is second degree murder. Unlawful killing, express malice, no deliberation or premeditation, it's second degree murder. On the other hand, where you have an intentional act that is committed after an opportunity to weigh and think about what one is about to do, it becomes a willful, deliberate, and premeditated murder. And that's what we have here. Some murders are spontaneous. They happen quickly without much thought. Typical example is a barroom fight. Two guys go to a bar to have a good time. One disrespects the other, and 2 seconds later, a beer stein is being slammed into somebody's head and kills them. Okay? There's no opportunity for any real deliberation or premeditation in that act. You're going to have a default second-degree murder. Unlike these circumstances where Mr. Holder had plenty of time, a full 10 minutes passed after that conversation and the time he returned and committed the shooting. And we know in that time he prepared his gun, he armed himself with a second gun, and all of the facts that I discussed earlier this morning, plenty of evidence of premeditation and deliberation. Again, does not take a long time. Premeditation and deliberation is not measured by how much time somebody spends thinking about it. A cold, calculated decision to kill can be reached very quickly. The law recognizes that. In this case, you had quite a bit of time for premeditation and deliberation. 10 minutes is a long time to think about something and then do it. Now, this instruction here, heat of passion, and this is where the defense is going to argue to you that this cold-blooded, this cold and calculated killing should be mitigated. And the theory that you're going to hear is it should be mitigated because Nipsey Hussle himself provoked Mr. Holder to attack him. That Nipsey Hussle did something that was so powerful, it caused an almost irresistible response in Mr. Holder to kill him. That's what heat of passion is. That's how it's defined in the law. The judge gave you an instruction. Language from the instruction. To reduce an unlawful killing from murder to manslaughter upon the ground of sudden quarrel or heat of passion, the provocation must be of the character and degree as would naturally excite and arouse the passion, and the assailant must act under the influence of that sudden quarrel or heat of passion. Elsewhere in the instruction, the question to be answered is whether or not at the time of the killing, the reason of the accused was obscured or disturbed by passion to such an extent as would cause the ordinarily reasonable person of average disposition to act rashly and without deliberation and reflection, and from passion rather than from judgment. What is an example of the heat of passion that these instructions contemplate? I'll give you an example. Let's say, hypothetically, a parent comes home from work and goes up to the bedroom of her 10-year-old, 12-year-old, 14-year-old child and finds an adult in the bed doing sexual activities with that child. And in that moment, that parent becomes blind with rage and attacks that older person and kills him. The question at that person's trial would be reasonably whether or not that person acted in the heat of passion. That in the bed with her child provoked her to act rashly and without judgment. Those are the kinds of facts that we're talking about when we talk about heat of passion. A classic example is adultery. Spouse comes home and finds partner in bed with another person, and without thinking, without considering, reaches for something, kills one or the other or both. It's always almost immediate. It's almost always the product of blind rage. There is no consideration in a true heat of passion killer. Compare and contrast those facts with what we have here. Under those facts, that provocation is so powerful that it can move a reasonable person of ordinary disposition to act rashly and violently. Comparing, contrast those facts to what we have here. A conversation in which Nipsey Hussle is actually doing Mr. Holder a favor, never called him a snitch. There's no evidence he ever called him a snitch. Yet two people witnessed that conversation. No one said Nipsey called him a snitch. And even if he had, snitching is so common. You heard from multiple gang experts, including one called by the defense, that people talk in the hood all the time. And they talk to police officers all the time. There's paperwork abound. It's not uncommon. It's not the kind of thing, even being accused of being a snitch is not the kind of thing that would move a reasonable person to kill. It just is. It might make you mad. It might make you angry. But it's not going to move an ordinary person of reasonable, average disposition to kill.
Objection. It states the law.
Ladies and gentlemen, as I've indicated in the beginning of the case, and I did with the bulk of my instructions, the lawyer follows is that which I give you. All right. So attorneys may misquote, you may repeat it exactly, but what you follow is what I give you.
Thank you. I just read some of the instruction to you. You'll have it. I submit to you that the heat of passion destruction is limited and to explicitly defined circumstances that would move a reasonable person of average disposition to act rashly. Not the reasonable gang member, the reasonable person. I'll give you another example. Getting fired is not a pleasant thing. People get fired all the time. And it causes a range of emotions, from sadness to disappointment to anger. Reasonable people who get fired do not kill the person who fired, even though it's not a pleasant thing to be told you don't have a job anymore. So what we're talking about...
No, excuse me. As I just said, ladies and gentlemen, the law is as I gave it to you and only as I gave it to you. All right?
You want to make an approach?
Yes, you may.
Thank you.
person to be consumed by rage, so much so that their whole thought process is obscure. We don't have that. We have a step-by-step, methodically carried out plan to return to that parking lot and kill. It's not done in the heat of passion. In fact, it's done 10 minutes after the conversation. In fact, it's done after he shakes Nipsey Hussle's hand when he walks away. Counsel, through his questioning, suggested that when Eric Holder walked over to that group for the first time and shook everybody's hand, he walked away without shaking Nipsey's hand. Not true. If you watch the video, you'll see he shook everybody's hand before he walked away. Now, when he returned with his food, Nipsey was already in a different area talking to someone else, and his client shook hands with the people who were closest to him, and he left again. Okay? This is a man who leads a conversation talking about his CD, not about snitching, not about having hurt feelings. He's talking about his music. Shakes everybody's hand, goes and gets food, gets in a car and leaves. Drives around the block, parks the car, eats some food, put on a shirt. He's not consumed by rage. Matter of fact, at one point he's in the Master Burger giving his phone number to another girl who's in the Master Burger. And this is after he's supposedly consumed by rage. No way do these facts support a heat of passion mitigation verdict in this case. And even if, and it pains me to ask you to assume this, but even if you felt that Nipsey Hussle did something to provoke him, there is a cooling off period. Even if you thought that that conversation was enough to throw a person into this excited an irresistible emotional state, he left. He left for 10 minutes. 10 minutes is a long time. It's a short time period of time, but it's also a long time for what we're talking about in this context. If I ask you to just take 10 minutes and I stop talking and we waited 10 minutes, you see how long 10 minutes is. It's actually quite a long period of time to be in your thoughts. So, to the extent that counsel asks you to find his client guilty of voluntary manslaughter instead of first-degree murder because of this, you should reject it. And you should reject it on the strength of his own witness's testimony. Let's go through a couple of things that his expert said yesterday. So we're talking about so-called snitching, which is supposed to be, you know, this thing that nobody does, and if they do it, people get killed when they do it, which I think has been thoroughly disproven. This is from Mr. Freeman. Question, and it is surprising, isn't it, how forthcoming gang members are with information? Answer, same way they are on the streets. Question, talk all the time? Answer, talk all the time. All the time. Talk to police, talk to whomever, talk to each other. Just full of talk. Some of it true, some of it not true. But this notion that nobody snitches or nobody tells, you know from this case isn't true. How many people talk to the police about what happened that day? How many people testified at the grand jury? How many people have come to court? And nothing has happened to any of them. And in fact, Mr. Freeman said what? He talked to hundreds, thousands of people? I forget what the number was. Over his 26 years, No one ever got killed from talking to him about a case. Is it possible? Yes. Does it happen occasionally? Yes. But that doesn't make it such that a reasonable person of ordinary disposition was simply warned that other people are saying this about you would be moved to act rashly. What else did Mr. Freeman say? Here at the bottom of this transcript, the question was, there are a lot of rumors that go around the neighborhood about different people, correct? Answer, that's rumors is the first thing you have to deal with. Question, is just a rumor? Answer, yes, right. And when there is a rumor going around about a gang member, you know, somebody put some dirt on his rep, right? Uh-huh. And then I gave an example, saying that maybe he was seen talking to the police, and then the rumor started. Does that gang member have an opportunity to address that rumor or rumors like that? It was an objection, overruled, and the witness said, now, when you say opportunity, are you saying he can come to the gang if he, I'm sure he's going to hear about the rumor. So, yeah, he does have the opportunity to face it. Question, okay, so it is not uncommon when there are rumors going around about somebody for a person to hear about it and then address it. Answer, that's correct. Question, that happens all the time. Answer, yes. Question, and in addressing that rumor, that person can do anything from deny it to go and get some kind of document and present it and say, look, that's a rumor. Look what the police report says. Defendant 2 did not give a statement. Answer, that's correct. Question, happens often? Answer, yes. And there are other examples in Mr. Freeman's testimony. I'll just give one more. And I asked him, you reviewed material in this case. Hypothetically, well, let me go to what you reviewed. You reviewed material that there was a conversation between Nipsey Hussle and Mr. Holder in which Nipsey Hussle told him that there was some word on the street that he had been talking or giving information. But there was some paperwork that he hadn't seen himself, but he just wanted him to know that was out there. Did you see that? Mr. Freeman said, yes, I did. Question, okay. That kind of an admonition or warning or advice or whatever label you want to put on it is common in the hood amongst homies, amongst friends. Is that correct? Answer, yes. This is common, ordinary stuff. Question, and the expectation, if any, the person telling the other person that may not care what happens, but the expectation is, I want you to know this, so if you want to address it, you can. So you don't get caught slipping. You don't get caught off guard not knowing this is going around. Wouldn't you agree? Answer, I agree. So to the extent that someone tries to tell you that one homie telling the other homie, hey, this rumor's going around about you, is some kind of outrageous, provocative act that's so slanderous that it throws somebody out of their right way of thinking, is nonsense. And it comes from the witness, the defense called to the stand. It's also buttressed by the witness I called, Gaxiola. Between Gaxiola and Mr. Freeman, they have almost 50 years of experience in dealing with gang culture. and both of them said the same thing. These rumors are common. Getting severely hurt or killed is rare. It is not the kind of thing that belongs in a realistic discussion about heat of passion. Heat of passion is for that child molester who's molesting somebody's child and that person loses it and kills them. That's what heat of passion is for, not for this. Can you switch me back? I want to show you a video that I put together. I put together a compilation of clips. I believe that's what this is. I put together a compilation of clips. We're going to look at all the video we have in sequence from Mr. Holder's arrival to the shooting. And I want you to see at no time is he acting out in a rage or acting uncontrollable or showing any signs of any extreme anger or that his emotions have overcome his reason. Start from the end of that conversation, that first conversation. He has walked over to the group. He's in the group. Brianita has already come over and taken her picture and gone back to her car. And this is how the conversation ends. You're going to see Mr. Holder shake hands, slap hands, bump fists with everybody in this group, including Nipsey Hussle. That's how that conversation ended. After he discussed whether they had heard his CD. And then he walks away and we'll follow him throughout the season. Right there is where he bumps fists with Nipsey, Cowboy, and then he walks away. that provocation has to be of such character and degree to excite passion in a reasonable person. You don't have. The killing has to be done rashly, without thinking, and while the person is still under the influence of this provocation. Again, walking into a bedroom, seeing something, and acting immediately without thinking. Not driving away and driving around the block and getting your gun ready and all that nonsense. It has to be something that would move an ordinary person to act rationally. The defendant is not permitted to set up his own standard. It's not a subjective test. It's an objective test, whether a reasonable person would act this way, not the defendant. And again, no cooling off period, which even if you had a provocative act here, you have plenty of time for him to cool off from it. Eat his fries and go back to Long Beach and make some music. Nevertheless, the defense will probably make that argument to you. And we'll see. A couple other instructions, ladies and gentlemen, that I'm going to be done. I wanted to talk a little bit more about, for whatever reason, I can't get my computer to behave today. So I'm just going to do this real passionate about this. All right, let's do this. We talked about attempted murder. And the attempted murder is really predicated on, as I said earlier, a desire to kill everybody in that group. The target is Nipsey for sure. That's who he really wants. But he's got to account for the other people who are there. And that's why he shoots them. He doesn't shoot them by accident. Bullets aren't passing through Nipsey and going into other people. Bullets fly straight. He's pointing the gun and he's hitting who he can to either take them out, and if they run away and escape, good for them. And that's what happened with two of the four of them. They ran away and escaped. Shermie was hit. Rimfall wasn't. But you gotta appreciate the space between these two cars, too. It's narrow. And he knew that. He knew, as he walked up on this group, that there were other people there and that they were all vulnerable and that he was gonna get the jump on all of them. He sized it up from the time he turned that corner and walked along that sidewalk in front of those storefronts and carried out his plan to a T. Was able to do all of this damage and escape and get back down to Long Beach for a couple of days safely. Direct but ineffectual act. That's all an attempt is. Direct but ineffectual act. The shooting. Let's see if I can highlight. So Holder is here. He's a little dark here. Let me go back. Okay, you can see him walking between the two cars here. Now that's what I was talking about with Nipsey is the first to react. Let's take a look at that. Everybody's stationary looking, at least Nipsey is looking directly at Holder. Nobody knows what's up at this point. And then we see Nipsey's arm come up. And then he drops. Shermie is facing the group. After Nipsey drops, he takes one step and then turns. He Lathan still has his back up against the car. This is Lathan. This is Rimpaw. His back is still up against the car. So Nipsey's already down. Shermai is turning to run. And then Lathan tries to run. And then he gets shot. And he drops. Rimpaw is able to get out of here. If all he wanted to do was shoot Nipsey Hussle, he was so close he could reach out and touch him. All he wanted to do was shoot Nipsey Hussle, he could have just shot Nipsey Hussle. And that's why we charge these crimes as attempted murder. Again, they're also charged as assault with firearms. So it will be up to you to decide whether we met our burden of proving these are attempted murders or assault with firearms. The last few things I want to say is you're going to see other allegations. Put this one up, infliction of great bodily harm. What great bodily harm means in the law is a significant or substantial physical injury. Okay, you're going to see this alleged as to Lathan, not Shermai. Shermai got the superficial wound to his torso. So we didn't allege great bodily injury for that one. We alleged it as to Lathan because obviously he got shot in the back. Bullet inoperable, still in him, ineffective. He's in the hospital for 3 weeks. After that, he needed a walker. Counsel showed you a video of him giving a press conference. If you look closely, he's in a wheelchair. This is some weeks after the shooting and after he's out of the hospital. So great bodily injury doesn't mean you lose a limb or you have some life-altering injury. It just means an injury that is significant. And I submit to you, every gunshot wound is significant if it pierces your body. The one that Shermai suffered, the way the bullet hit him, we don't think that that is great bodily injury. So this allegation only goes to Lathan.
To talk about what assault is, it's pretty simple. You point a gun at somebody with a gun, pointing a gun at someone is an assault, whether you pull the trigger or not.
There are some gun use allegations that I want to just talk briefly about, just so you're not confused. Use of a gun means exposing a gun in a menacing manner. If a person commits a robbery and pulls out a gun and says, "Give me your wallet," he's using the gun in the eyes of the law. Use does not require discharge. So you'll see all of the crimes 1 through 5 allege use of a gun. You'll also see an allegation that alleges discharge of a gun, and that obviously applies when a gun is fired. And then you'll see discharge of a gun causing great bodily injury or death. And obviously, in this case, Nipsey was killed. So you had death. And we allege you have great bodily injury even with regard to Lathan. So you're going to see 3 different gun allegations. They're going to apply to mostly the same crimes. Again, there's redundancy there that's anticipated. Don't worry about it. You're considering each charge separately, without any thought of the fact that there's some redundancy, okay?
The discharge, the TBI, and then finally, possession of a firearm by a convicted felon.
Okay. So, I went through the people's theory of the case, both in terms of what happened, the evidence that supports it, and the law. Mr. The defense, I don't know.
will have an opportunity to address you and give you their version of what happened and their idea of what the law is. And then I'll get an opportunity to address you one more time. But because I say everything up front, I want the defense to have an opportunity to rebut everything I have to say. I assure you my second argument won't be as long and it won't be redundant. But I do thank you for your time and your attention so far today.